say about some of the points that you raised. So now I'm going to introduce the panelists. We'll begin with Dr. Dax Basdale, if you could join us on the platform. He's the Chief Officer of the Ministry of Financial Services and Home Affairs. Dr. Basdale has worked with Cayman Islands government for over 8 years, and his expertise has been invaluable in delegation visits across the globe, as well as various government initiatives. And more recently, we were actually delighted that he served as one of our panelists for our breakfast briefing recently. Also joining him will be Colin Robinson. Colin is the Vice Chairman of the Insurance Managers of Cayman. He's also a treasurer of our Chamber of Commerce. Colin is the Director at Strategic Risk Solutions and has worked in the captive insurance industry for over a decade. The discussion will be moderated by President Paul Biles, and then turn it over to Paul for some discussion. And by the way, if you would like to get a coffee break, don't do it all at once, but it is available in the lobby courtesy of our sponsor, BDO.
Thanks, Will. I actually don't feel like doing this, so can I get a chair?
I mean, I'll do this. but I don't want to stand. Yeah, so I'm just kidding. All right. Yeah. Ask everyone to just take a seat this way. Everybody sit down, please. So don't have to just write, you know, how I like it. So. Yeah, so I can be here. And that's what Steve did when he was here. He sat here, so I like to do what Steve McIntosh does. I am going to be looking at my phone occasionally, and it's not because I'm texting a girl or anything, because my wife is sitting right here, just so everybody knows. It's very clear. I'm not texting her either, but that'll be very strange. I'll start by just asking a more general question about industry. And I'll ask Dax to jump in. Given the enormous pressure that we're seeing over many years, constant enormous pressure on industry to make changes, and the pressure against the offshore world, and now called IFCs, it doesn't really matter, but the same pressure comes. What's the general feeling about your prospect of the industry in the longer term? We feel that it's good, sustainable, it's going to be all okay, or do we have any concerns?
I'm happy to lead off. I have very positive expectations on it, but I believe it comes down to what we have on the screen there. It's about properly investing in the industry, properly deploying our resources, and having that real partnership where an organization like Cayman Finance is used on a proactive basis for consulting with government and the CIMA, and not on a reactive basis. There was actually a fantastic meeting with the Premier, for example, recently, where there's clear interest from the Premier, hearing from organizations like Cayman Finance, working with us, getting thoughts and insights. That's something I think we want to continue encouraging, and also with the ministry, to be doing that in a more proactive basis going forward. I think we have huge, huge opportunities. We have great teams in the ministry, in CIMA, and in industry, and we just need to leverage them.
Well, I think that one of the key things you said was that we have been under threat for the better part of 15, 20 years. And I guess the public isn't aware of all the challenges we've been facing, but this is a non-stop barrage of initiatives, the good, at least in the last 10 years. We've been very successful in facing each one. And I think in large part is because we realize that we've had a very strong, good story to tell as an industry. Jude made some of those points in terms of the depth and breadth of expertise. And that has really allowed us to not only keep up with, but in some cases, help to contribute towards various initiatives and standards. From a government perspective, we have started taking the view that we must be very engaged. And we've seen the results of that in more recent times, where because of our direct engagement with partners and other jurisdictions and other authorities, we've built very strong relationships so they understand our story a lot better. And that's gotten us through a good few initiatives in the last 5 years. Currently, we have a different set of challenges. We're very much focused on trying to overcome them. But because, as Jude said, we have this depth and breadth of expertise, because of the level of innovation in this industry, we adapt. Every time something happens, we adapt. So yes, and I think we are all concerned right now with the latest decisions in the UK. But that's not the end of the industry. This is not a thing that's going to happen for another 2 years at the very least. And of course, from what the mayor said, it's not going to end in 2 years. We're going to make sure we fight this. So are we going to adapt? Yes. Do we have long-term survival? Yes. That's what we've been doing for the last decade plus. I think we're going to continue to do it.
The next question concerns diversification. I'm going to start with Colin. Colin has a lot of expertise in the insurance industry. My view is that the industry has grown primarily, or certainly in large part, due to the investment fund sector over the past decade. I think there's any dispute on that. It's grown because of banking and trust and private business, that's fine. But a particular enormous source of that growth has come from investment funds and all the support around that, all the employment around that, all the new offices, everything around that. Colin, can you say something about insurance? Because when we talk about insurance, I think we talk about the fact that we're the number one in healthcare. And we always mention that we're number two in the captives. The number of insurance licenses has actually over the years has decreased, but I'm sure maybe the capitalization or the premium is still very high. But can you say something about the strength of insurance and where it goes in the future? Are we facing more competition, less competition?
Well, always more competition. So right now we have 30 plus states in the United States that have captive enabling legislation. So we have competition both in the offshore and the onshore arena. Now, the onshore arena is essentially the same models we use here, so apples to apples is a pretty close comparison when it comes to the actual models of how you service your clients. As far as diversification within our current industry, the insurance industry specifically, about 35 to 36% of the business has been healthcare related. So think of any large healthcare network in the United States that's decided to form a captive locally, to use that as a vehicle to increase the risks they currently have. Now, it's interesting, we've seen, because of some regulatory things that have gone in other domiciles that happen to be in the Atlantic Ocean that we won't name, they've actually lost some of that B3 business. When I say B3, it's a license category of 50% or more unrelated business. So we're actually seeing diversification within licensees, so that percentage of healthcare business is still roughly around the same, but declines in that business aren't going to be because of declines within the actual business. It's because of those other lines of business. So we're seeing other companies being interested in setting up essentially mini reinsurance companies down here. So it's been a market that's been diversifying quite a bit over the last year or 2 years.
Okay. Jude, what about diversification outside insurance? So what I do see is the number of banks in the private business, it has shrunk. Right? There's absolutely no doubt that it has shrunk. And even though the number of bank licenses has dropped, we are also aware that the number of assets and deposits within the banking system is still very high. Nonetheless, the number of actual operating entities which employ staff and pay fees has dropped. So I want to ask you, because you have the bird's eye view of all of this, we seem to be narrowing down our options a bit or losing some portions of business, but do you see opportunities for other new areas to kind of fulfill that loss?
Yeah, so I think we have some interesting trends which have happened over time. So if we look at our banking space, for example, at one point in time we had 500 plus banks here in Cayman. When we look in sort of the Class B category, they're a mix of either global banks with subsidiaries or branches, or you could also have what we would actually call today family offices, right? Where folks have significant wealth. One of the ways to express yourself with that wealth is have on your own bank. Do business through that. It's really an extension of sort of a trust company type environment. What we're seeing is now with things like AML and KYC, you still have to declare exactly who you are behind it, and so a lot of those structures don't have the same type of benefit anymore. And we're seeing consolidations with banks globally. But as you say, we still have very, very strong deposits. So I think that's probably been a natural trend over time. When we look at the different areas for us, so I take a step back and I compare financial services to technology. So in technology, 20 years ago if you graduated from university, those skills that you attained at that point in time are totally irrelevant and outdated now, but technology is not outdated. So it's about continuing to evolve, understand what the business needs, and developing those new skills and talent. for that space because technology is more relevant now than ever before. When we look at our core, what we do is we're connecting folks that have investment capital and financing with those who need investment capital and financing. So as long as the world needs investment capital and financing, and we have the right products and services, and we have the right service delivery methodology, and the right legislation and regulation to support that, we will continue being a domicile that's used. So we may see, for example, where, say, the hedge fund space, we've seen hedge funds have sort of reached the plateau, but we see our private equity space, or venture capital space, is growing rapidly. We also see, in terms of opportunities, where the US may be a fairly mature market, Asia is a new market of opportunity where we're seeing a lot of demand for investment products over there. Things like capital markets, it's about making sure that we're creating the awareness. One of the stats, for example, with the UK is the UK currently receives foreign direct investment into about 1.2% of their businesses. But those 1.2% of UK businesses generate about 18% of the employment in the UK. Here we are sitting in Cayman with probably the largest pooled amount of capital. And this is where we have opportunities to sit with the UK to understand you don't have to be searching around the world. How does Cayman help provide that by working with you to remove hard and soft barriers that may prevent access to it?
Does the ministry see any challenge in diversification or the need for it? Or from a policy point of view, do you see the need to create more legislation in your discussions with Cayman Finance and Industry? Are there some opportunities to further diversify?
Certainly. I think I've been involved in a number of chambers initiatives around diversification for the last few years. And I've been in various roles involved in some smaller industries trying to get started. But it all comes back down to what is your core strength and how do you build upon that? And I think from a financial services standpoint, that's something we have been doing for the past few years, working very closely with industry to understand the evolution of the products that they sell, understand what areas to get into, how to improve, how we do business. And that part has helped us to make sure we're making improvements year on year to protect the industry, to grow the industry. And now it's no different. Right now we are looking at other areas to grow in the fintech space, looking at blockchain technology, looking at other areas for growth, and working to get industry's expertise to bear and understand what the next step's going to be. So yes, it's very much part of our job on a day-to-day basis, working with industry, not just to fight these initiatives and make sure we are represented on a world stage, but to look at the next step and to build for future.
Can I talk a little bit about education? Cayman Finance has a lot of really good education initiatives. Colin, I know IMAC has a scholarship that it promotes 100 times a year, and lots of people are getting educated through that. But the general idea that I want to depict here is that, if you have a fishing village, right, you would want to ensure that every child born in that fishing village learns how to fish at some point. And it's a fishing village because it's close to the water, and that's why it's a fishing village. So we have, in this context, a financial services village. Are we doing enough to ensure that the next generation are acutely aware of the opportunities in financial services, getting educated, getting trained in the right ways, getting the right skill sets developed for financial services? Do you feel that we're doing enough in that? I know we're giving scholarships and that's great, but are we introducing them to the fishing early enough? Are we doing enough in terms of getting Cayman as more participation in the industry? The question is important because all industries are important, but in terms of middle income and higher income opportunities for Caymanians, specifically talking about opportunities for local people, financial services brings a disproportionate and very welcome amount of possibilities for Caymanians. So I would have thought it would be important to prepare them for that industry. I'll start with you, Colin. Well, do you think we're doing enough?
Wow. So I'll speak to our scholarship fund. We've had about a 20-year history of the scholarship fund, raised about $3.4 million and put 40-plus students through university, all Caymanian students. I actually did interviews with 8 young Caymanians today, and the future is bright. And we have another 40-plus to interview over the next couple of weeks. The future is incredibly bright. So from that perspective, as an industry body, we don't actually say that it's a requirement that they go into a financial services field. We try to give some preference to that. And I would just say, anecdotally, from working, obviously, as insurance manager over the last couple of years, I'm not sure if there is enough education that's really done. Because, you know, typically, the person, especially within our industry, is somebody who worked in the audit field, has now moved into out of that into insurance management field. So from that perspective, KMAGs are very highly prized in that role because there's so few that have gotten to that level, and there should be one. But again, you know, having seen some of the interviews we've done over the last couple of years, there is a huge pipeline of KMAGs who are coming, and there needs to be space for them.
True. Are we doing enough?
I would totally agree. I think as a country, we're not doing enough to prepare our young talent for the industries that are available. So financial services, we make up more than 50% of the economy, but only about 15% of the workforce. So we already do a huge lifting from an industry perspective in terms of scholarships, training programs, development. The programs that we do, for example, our student education program. And I think it's figuring out how I think we revamp the model. So if we look back many, many years ago, the kind of structured educational programs, say in the US, came about because they had factories. And they would bring people on board, they had to train everyone because there was no school for them to go to. And if they left that factory and went to another factory, they would have to retrain them because they had a totally different approach. So what they all agreed, the factory owners, is let's train people to specific standards that we can all use, and it's much more efficient for us to do. And I think that's where we've got away from. And some have just been development, like FinTech, as Dax said, is an exciting space for us that KMAN is probably gonna take a lead in, is how do we start with what are the marketplace opportunities locally and globally for our young people? What are the skills that the education system needs to prepare them for to be successful in those? And how do we make sure we have the right curriculum and teachers in place to deliver that?
Certainly, I think we can benefit from a lot more experience, you know, in being in industry. I think one thing we can do a lot better is explain just what variety of skill sets they do need in this industry. It's not just law or accounting, those are the very key industries to have them in, but a variety of backgrounds and knowledge, especially IT. So, yes, we can do more. Again, make sure that young persons know what range of skills is needed in the industry.
So, I want to touch on what amounts to 50% of Drew's presentation, which is the issue of funding and underfunding to finance. It was, right? So
was that
was one slide, actually. One slide. It was broken into about 16 parts, that one slide. But I want to talk about it because it's an important issue. And first, I'm going to ask Drew if you can succinctly give us all a sense of what are the areas that would benefit from the increased funding? And just in a summary, what areas do you think need that extra support for the industry?
Absolutely. So when we look at funding, part of it is just having the resources. So being able to bring on board lobby firms, being able to bring on board firms that are going to be able to do the political intelligence and the market intelligence. And for example, government has in place, I think, a resource that pulls together that type of information for them. They spend maybe $500,000 a year on that, but we don't have access to that information. So we're kind of running blind a bit. So having the ability to have the information, also being able to have our own in-house people who can do research. So when we're getting ready for presentations and trips, we're actually doing research, we're looking at what's readily available, but we're positioning ourselves well to do that. You know, when we look at, for example, the ability to defend ourselves and at the same time be able to promote the jurisdiction in marketing and business development, then we need to also expand our resources to do that. I think Bermuda Business Development Agency has probably 15 or 16 people do what I do. Jersey Finance has over 30 people do what I do. So when you start trying to divide up my time or our small team, all of a sudden it's, you know, we're dealing with the EU blacklist, we're dealing with central public registers, we're trying to do research projects, we're preparing for TV interviews. So the ability to really have a platform and base where we can be more proactive, we can actually take longer term strategies. Right now we're having to be very proactive, and I say to folks, like, I apologize if I don't respond to your email, but literally I wake up in the morning, whatever the priority is that morning, I don't have a base that I can pass emails on to, I just have to deal with whatever the learning platform is. So the ability for us to be able to deal with a lot of these issues, there's probably 30 threats on the jurisdiction right now, right? What you're seeing is just the tip of the iceberg, the stuff that's making it into the press. The ability to actually deal with all of those and have strategies and work with government and develop our approach on those, and then cover the cost. One of the challenges that we've had is it's been limited in terms of what we can actually spend the funds from government on. So for example, because there's, government has a preference right now, which I'm hoping they'll change after this discussion, is that they prefer us to not engage with politicians in the UK and in Brussels. If I were to take a trip over and spend a week in London and meet with government officials, politicians, meet with folks from quasi-governmental bodies, the ministry would probably tell me this is where backs and hands are a bit handcuffed, right? Would tell me we can't cover any of those costs. But yet those are very, very valuable things that we can do as what I would call, we're now in a heavy lobby phase.
Dax, is it the case that there just isn't enough resources? What is it? Is it, or do you feel differently about the extent to which the support is needed? Do you feel you're doing as much as you can, or is this just your hands are tied because there's no budget?
Well, I think it's important to recognize that the Ministry of Transport Services is a fairly new ministry. It was only really formed in 2013 as its own ministry in that sense. And since that time, the budget allocation has been increasing as we have grown up to try to do all this initiative. So from a funding perspective, I think the government has recognized that it does need to invest more in financial services, so it started doing so. And year on year, we've had increases as we've grown an increased number of initiatives. Funding for CEMA has also grown tremendously because of the level of regulation that's now required, given all the various standards that we are following. And those have been some significant jumps in some pretty lean years as well. The money procurement finance is now at a high point in the last few years. And certainly there's room for growth. I think what's the next step in my mind is make sure we have very clear strategies how to attack and defend ourselves against all these initiatives, make sure we spend our money wisely. And as plans become clearer, we're doing that. Certainly engagement is the biggest part of it. And that has really increased in the last 2 years in particular, so it's in the right direction.
On the issue of strategy, I think, because that's one of the things I was looking at when Julie mentioned funding, and I thought about, well, outreach and promotion and research and policy, and there's so much stuff, right? But what about the long-term strategy for financial services? We've been very lucky, in my view, in the sense that we've been able to ride out lots of changes globally all the time and continue to be successful despite everyone thinking that the change is going to be some major catastrophe, and it hasn't occurred. And that's very good. We've also been in the right place at the right time. We've launched legislation before other countries back in 1993, mutual funds and other things that we've done. But are we still innovative as we were, you know, because you were there in the industry. Are we still as innovative today? That's number one. But two, and most importantly, do we actually have a strategy, and shouldn't we have a longer term strategy that benefits, forget about us, but two generations behind us? If we're looking to sustain an industry that continues to be attacked in this way, and is susceptible to this type of attack, the nature of attack, that's just said 20 years, right? Isn't it time for us to, forget about us, for you guys, for Cayman Finance and government to sit together and come up with a long-term written, documented strategy that's guided by proper research and feedback from client groups and so on to take the country forward? I feel that document doesn't exist, but that's my outside observation. Isn't it time for something like that? Start with that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, it is time for that. I think we have been very reactive in some sense the past decade, primarily because as these initiatives have come up, we've been forced to respond and prepare for them. But that said, because we have been we think the approach will be much more engaged. We've had a bit more of a lead time in the past few years to know what the next thing is and to prepare for it. So from that standpoint, although we are reacting, we've had some lead time in order to make sure we are, you know, what's right to protect the industry. Interesting enough, at this point in time, I'm not sure what the next initiative is. I think the ones that we have with here right now, between the blacklist, the bit of actual ownership, the AML to the FATF standards, BEPS initiative and others, I think the world as a whole is playing catch up with all of what's been done in the past few years. From a standards perspective, because of all these changes, we are in an unstable environment from a regulatory perspective, and it's hard to be a bit more proactive and planning strategy at this point, not knowing what the next step is going to be. Until all the various international regulators and all the various government bodies who are involved in these processes come to grips with the data that they're starting to see, we don't know what's next on the horizon. I think we're at a point where we've done so much in the past 3 to 4 years just trying to keep up with all these initiatives. We do need to take a step back to reassess where we are as an industry, look at how things are organized, how we're conducting ourselves, how all the parts fit together, and try and make it stronger and better. And I think that's the point where we are at now between Ministry and Cabinet Finance, particularly looking at how to develop that strategy. But given the current situation, it's hard to be more proactive and that kind of foresight where we're trying to deal with issues right now.
I would just echo that. I think
you agree with that?
I always agree with that. I just think a little differently. It's what comes after the agreement that you get the. I think we're at a very, very interesting point in time where our business model itself is not what's on the threat. The products and services that we offer to clients are exceptional, and they've been built based on a foundation of top quality clients, top quality services, and they are needed in the world. So when we look forward, you know, part of our strategy should always be how do we make the same widgets better going forward, and we have to focus on that. Another part of our strategy is, can we add other types of widgets to it? And the other types of widgets fall in the big broad areas of, you know, what we're doing with One Belt, One Road with China, for example, what we're doing with our FinTech initiative. You know, we're working on a certified digital ID platform for Cayman, which could totally differentiate Cayman from other competitors and drive more business to Cayman. So we have these areas that we're working on. One of the challenges now is because of the landscape is changing so rapidly, and in fact shared, there's so many different threats, challenges coming, that it's kind of pointless to look 5 years out because all of the change is happening immediately right in front of us now. So I think it's about having sufficient resources, having the ability to collaborate and work together so that we're doing multiple things at the same time. We're protecting, we're growing what we currently have, and also we're doing innovation at the same time.
Colin? My history in the financial services industry, the crisis that I can remember when I first started was the EU Savings Directive, and that was going to crush us back then. We've gone from that to countless things in the meantime. Our biggest strength has been the fact that through government, through volunteers working in the financial services industry, we've always been able to respond to that and come out ahead. And I don't see a strategy that is going to lay out 5-10 years where we're going to go is something that, you know, we could have that as an ideal, but there's always going to be something that's going to be thrown at us. And it's simply a fact that those in other domiciles and other jurisdictions, they like what we have. And they'd like to, in the case of, let's just, you know, look at CAFA. As I said, there's 30-some states in the U.S. They don't want those companies to have those businesses outside of their own home state. That's why they, you know, do that legislation, because they like that piece of business. Our greatest strength is the fact that over the last several years, we've been able to respond. Looking at the industry cooperation that we really slapped together in a very short time on this new blacklist, it's not short time in the amount of, you know, time that we were given, it's not the time that it really was able to be utilized. I think it just shows the strength that as a financial services industry, as a large group that we do have, and I think it just bodes well for the future of us being able to respond to whatever that next directive is.
It sounds to me that we, at this end of this, it sounds like we're too busy dealing with the short to medium term to think about the long term.
as effective as the response I just got from all three of you. And that's okay, because that's life. We'll get to that when we get to that, when we don't have all these storms, and you mentioned the Cat 5, all sort of category hurricanes coming. But I'm gonna open it up to the floor for any questions. I think we'll take a couple of questions if there are any. Seems to be
one question.
There's one? We only have one market. We only have one apartment. Make it multi-faceted. Yeah, multi-faceted.
So, Dr. Mateo earlier mentioned blockchain as a possible future growth segment. And from what I understand, there's already been an influx of blockchain companies coming onto the island. What is the ministry, Kevin Finance, and SEMA doing in terms of accounting, monitoring, and regulation of these companies? And since they are already here, are we letting them in before there's an accepted worldwide standard in terms of the regulation?
This is an instance where technology is moving very fast, faster than we can sort of adapt the current model we have to address them. So we do know that it's in a growing area. Government has been working with SEMA to understand what the next step is. We've had some internal discussions, and we'll be looking to initiative to have their input to design the right regulatory environment so those types of companies can come here and flourish. I think one of the points Jude made is a very important one, is that because we are operating at a very high standard, we want to make sure we have good business, good clients. And just because an area is growing rapidly with perhaps all kinds of various models in that space, doesn't mean that they're right for Cayman. We want to make sure we keep out the bad actors. And so while we are in some ways delayed in getting the right framework in place, I do think that we have a very capable industry to understand the importance of AML and CFD regulations and having those standards. And as they're trying to work these companies coming in, I'm hoping that they're doing their part to make sure they're keeping the bad actors out at this point in time.
If I can just add to that very quickly as well, is my personal thought, not representative of Cayman Finance or board of directors, and not just personal thought, is I think we're at a very interesting time globally, in that we're in what I would call wave two of countries trying to adopt this type of new technology into their financial services industries. So wave one was countries said, this is great technology. How do we apply our current legislation regulation to it? And it doesn't work because it was originally designed for example, for use with, say, cryptocurrencies. It was designed to be anonymous. It was designed to be unregulated. There are no intermediaries. Our current bricks and mortar regulatory model is regulated transactions via regulated intermediaries. There is none in this technology. So wave two was which countries are now in, saying, okay, we still want all of this technology the way it is. Can we change our legislation regulation to make it work? What we're working on from a Cayman perspective is what I call wave three, which is there's aspects of the technology that should not be brought into financial services industry. Anonymity, unregulated, does not work in financial services. How do we take the good elements of it, bring those across, and how do we take the sound elements of regulation and bolt it into the technology? And that's where I think the world's gonna end up. Our goal is to get there first, and so we have the right clients, the right solutions for it.
Thanks, guys. I think I'll just end here. Please join me in thanking the Oops, wait. Also, false alarm, I'm getting stopped by.
I got the privilege of last question. First of all, Docs, tell everyone be proud of yourself, please. You've taken a shot, trust me. Seriously, when you look at the situation and all of the sort of slides of the presentation that you gave us, what I struggle to understand is this. If there's a point in time where we're supposed to be defending the thing that makes Cayman successful and drive the economy, which is the financial services industry, and that's this isn't your fault, you're having to carry the load as a government representative, what will it take for them to understand that this is the time to rally the troops, put all of the other projects on pause, i.e. a proposed $300 million cruise berthing project, at a time when you're potentially going to lose, being conservative here, anywhere between 15 and 30%
of your financial services revenue if and when this thing goes to the wall and we are unsuccessful in the challenge that the Premier is proposing about the constitutional overreach and so on and so forth. I say all of that to say this. Cayman Airways gets a subsidy of $23 million for services. They claim to make a profit, but if I was given $20 million to start off my business, I would probably make a profit with that as well. I say all of that to say this. There's a time when Dax and Jude are supposed to be on the same team, and the people who are responsible for allocating your budgets are saying, guys, whatever it takes, we're going to defend that source of revenue because that's what gives us the kingdom, that's what gives us the risk, that's what gives us all of our construction and development sort of revenue. So what would it take for them to get it? Because it feels as if we're painting the outside of the walls and the roof is on fire. Thank you very much.
I'm not actually sure that that question would target at anyone on this panel. I think it was like a great point that was made for everybody to hear, especially those people outside the room. and I hope they heard you. But any comments before we close? Thanks.
I would say, I mean, it's a good point. The past few years, we have been dealing effectively with these challenges. I think the environment in which we are working to sort of defend Cayman has changed slightly. We're now seeing NGOs who are very well funded, exploiting illegal activity in the form of leaks of information to make points that are not true. And unfortunately, we're faced with a general public in the world that believes these points and are putting political pressure on the government to take action. And while we have tried to influence the politics of the past few years by working with the technical side of governments, so they have the facts at hand. That's not what the world is we're living in right now. We're living in a world where the misperception of the public is having a direct impact on the political decision making in other jurisdictions. And it's not based on the technical inputs coming in from the side we've been working for the last few years. We recognize that shift perhaps a bit late, and we're going to try and address more of the sort of general perception issues. But it is an uphill battle because I think the misperception of what Cayman is, we are the villain in the world stage, and we get mentioned no matter what for whatever reason, even if there's nothing that can show to link us to any activity. But that perception is so strong, we've got to tackle it head on now, and that's the next part in our approach.
I think we're going to have to stop there, unfortunately. Will?
Yes.
We have to end, right?
Yeah.
Can you please stand the panel again?